Thank you all for being here. As you know, this is basically an annual event for all the committees to come and to share their ideas. Basically, that's the purpose of this meeting. I'd like to start out the meeting by introducing our new assistant to the town administrator, Lisa Tarowski, with a Y.
Thank you.
With a Y. You may have heard that our last assistant to the town administrator, Rebecca Stone, was working for about 2 months. And the town, she was working for us part-time, and the town that she was working for, the other town she was working for, basically said, we're going to offer you a full-time position. So it was something that she couldn't turn down. So we were very lucky that Lisa was a very, very close second to Rebecca, and Tom went and called Lisa, and she was still available. So we're very happy to have Lisa. As I said, the purpose of this meeting is basically to share information on your present projects and any plans you have for future projects, and to give everybody an update, basically, and to see if there are any collaborative efforts that can be made among committees and boards and commissions. I've attended a number of meetings recently with state legislators and state officials, and they've spoken about revenue levels. Revenues for the state are not up to expectations. And although state officials have pledged that local distributions will continue to be given as they've stated to us and consistent with the past, we have to be prepared if they're reduced. I would ask all the boards, commissions, committees, departments to look to level fund the fiscal 2018 budget in accordance with the 2017 fiscal year budget. And if there are any cuts that can be made that don't affect services or employee compensation, please look into those seriously. That being said, let's start off. Ken has to be out of here early, so we're going to start with Ken.
I really have nothing. I'm no longer on any active committees, so I really have nothing going. If anybody has any questions, I'd be happy to try to answer those.
How about level of policing in town?
We lost one officer. I do have a female officer who's interested in coming aboard. She's a full-time officer in Deerfield. So we're discussing whether or not that will work for all parties interested.
Right. Any serious problems in town?
Yeah, last week we did have a break-in the Sunset Package Store. We're still working on that. No, nothing real serious. The heroin problem that has been plaguing most of New England, we have seen a little smattering of it, but nothing too serious yet in our community. But we expect it probably will increase like it has everywhere else.
Okay. Do you want to let everybody know that we've had two recent passings?
Recently, this weekend, Jerry Sommer passed away. And earlier this afternoon, Dick Pacey passed away.
Thank you, Ken. Any questions for Ken at all?
No information about weights? Or?
No, I have none at this point.
All right, why don't we go around the circle? Why don't we start over here? What do you have for us?
Russ French, one of the assessors. Lee couldn't make it tonight, so I'll try to do a little bit of fill-in here for her. This was a revaluation year. We've gone over most everything, buildings and private property, not property, but...
Revaluations.
Yeah, has pretty much stayed the same. Property has changed. The first 1 acre has increased significantly. basically, because that's what the sales of land around town have shown, that land values are up. Housing has basically stayed the same. So that's where part of the increase of the tax bill is. Also, the if you had a real increase in your tax bill, it's because you had a second building lot. If you didn't, if the property is not adjacent to your home lot, or if it's across the street or down the road and it's a second piece of property that you own that is not on the same deed, you are now getting charged for a building lot on that. So that has made the phone ring quite a few times.
Do you usually see, if there's an increase in land values, that's a precursor to an increase in housing value?
Right now, I don't think so. It doesn't appear that way. We did have a fair amount of new growth this year. Basically, the High Lines and the power station came back online after Irene did all the damage. But 2 weeks ago, and they agreed with the new assessment and that we had done and for this year. But then we got a letter a couple weeks ago saying that there was a new regulation, and I don't understand it. The letter didn't make it very clear that the water downstream is an asset, and the water downstream is a liability and the water upstream is an asset. So it's going to change considerably, and we may lose some of that new growth this coming year.
This next fiscal year, year 2018.
Right. Okay. And I don't know whether most of you know, we have almost reached our levy limit, which limits the amount we can tax, basically.
Yes.
Simply put, that's, so we just about reached that. So that's going to have a big effect on what we can spend.
Another reason why our boards and departments and commissions have to make sure they've got a tight budget this year.
Right. Another thing that has happened, we have seen a very large growth in people coming in and signing up for chapters. I mean, be it any one of the three. We've had an awful lot of people come in, put their land in chapter, and of course that reduces the taxes by 75%, roughly. So that's not helping our situation either. The outlook for new growth for next year is basically nil. I mean, there's a couple of new houses that'll be completed, but very, very little with the power companies or any of the phone or Comcast or any of those. It doesn't appear to be very much new growth for next year.
Can I ask if we've seen any McMansions? I think the Sheehan sold a 40-acre parcel. The Sheehan's sold a 40-acre parcel with one house lot in 1 week, I understand. Are we seeing a lot of people looking for big lots?
No, we have not seen a lot. I mean, there has been some, but basically real estate has not gone over real fast. I mean, there's some we have some places that have been on for sale for a couple, 3 years now that haven't moved. And we've also had some recent sales that were considerably less than what we had them assessed for. They weren't necessarily arm's length sales, but they still were a problem.
Russ, can I ask a question? When you said a lot of people filed for chapter, I don't know what that meant.
Well, we have chat.
You mean like APR and?
Well, no, APR is that's something like it, but we have chapters, like agricultural land is one, forestry land. If you have get a forestry forester to do a plan, you get a reduced rate. We also now have another chapter that is, if you put it in recreational land, in other words, it can't be posted, people can hunt or walk on it or whatever. And all those have a reduced rate. And we really, the assessors really don't have any choice. It's a state regulation, and if a person meets that regulation, I mean, it varies with each one of the chapters, but if they meet the regulations, we really don't have any say-so. We have to go ahead with it.
Thank you, Russ. Kate?
I'm holding his paperwork. Pardon me?
Nothing for us, Kate?
I'm supportive of Heidi, and if she needs me to chip in, I will.
Carl?
Hi. Carl Milkey, Board of Health. We're just doing the Board of Health thing. Things are pretty stable, running the, we've got 5 people on the board now, so there's a lot more stuff we can do. We're really zeroing in on Airbnbs, these places that just kind of come up like mushrooms, and when we hear of one, we have people go, especially if they're serving food, we have people that are going out inspecting those right away, so we're bringing them in on, you know, into the fold, so to speak.
Do we have a big increase in those in town?
Well, I'd say there's been over a half a dozen in the past few months. That we've come up with. It seems to be like a popular thing all of a sudden.
You don't have to do it here.
Yeah.
Could you share that information with the fire department, the ambulance department?
Absolutely. Sure.
Because, you know, sure. If we get a call to go to these places, and we, a lot of times, we don't hear about them at all.
Right. No, I'll make sure we can make that part of the process.
For us.
Yeah, we have a whole workup for each new one, so we'll just put notify fire department on there.
And
make sure that you find out about it.
You inspect their kitchen facilities?
If they're cooking, yeah.
Just like a restaurant?
Yep.
Yeah. Like a restaurant? They have to be meet restaurant standards?
Absolutely, they're serving food. Yeah. Or a B&B. You know, I mean, these are what they call Airbnbs, so they're like not on the radar because they're not registered, but like any B&B in town has to be inspected.
How's the compactor working out?
The compactor is good. You're doing really well. It's very reliable. And it's saving money. We're really able to make far fewer hauls because there's more weight in each one as they empty the compactor. So yeah, we're stuffing that thing full. It's working real well. In fact, the whole recycling effort up there is producing some interesting stuff. We got an award from the Franklin County Solid Waste Management District to the tune of $1,400, which is, you know, it's not the end of the earth, but the and actually there's another $500, so we're up to like $1,900 from the Franklin County Solid Waste District, and that's all based on the amount of recycling we do in this town and all the efforts that we have for it. And we were awarded this, you know, because we had good numbers for all the different things that we did.
Do we have more recycling coming in?
It's steadily increasing. It's not flat. It seems to be more recycling. Yes.
Any reason behind that? Thing?
I think people are more aware of what's going on. I think we got a good facility up there. Mm-hmm. We make recycling easy. For people to do, and the transfer station attendants, you know, encourage it also.
Yeah, they do a good job.
Yeah, they do, and they're real low key about it. You know, there's no dump Nazis or something like that. Mm-hmm. Oh God, that was funny.
Any big projects coming up?
Nothing really huge. I've been kind of talking with Ron about trying to clear off that knoll that you go over on your way out. We dug out there last year and found out it's pure rock. Mm. But we might be able to clear the trees off it and then be able to put something up there. Because there's talk about, you know, food waste, composting type facility,
right.
Need places for, you know, plastic bags, and just to give us more room. You know, wouldn't be a lot, but it'd
if
be
we
more
could just out. Level that out a bit.
We possibly can scrape some of that off, yeah. I don't know. But that's big money. All that stuff's big money.
Yeah.
So I don't know what, you know, I've had some estimates on it, and it's It's not cheap.
No, not at all.
But it would be attractive to do. It would really help us to have more programs going up there.
Sure. Any questions for Carl? Thank you, Carl.
Okay.
David.
Hi, I have two hats on tonight. The first one is the town park. I'd like to report on that because I know everyone is on the edge of their seats waiting to hear about that. In 2014, at a planning board meeting, we had a brief discussion that said, what are we going to do with that land down there on Sheldon Falls Road by the river? And several of us wondered about that, and we said, why don't we form a committee and figure it out? So it was at the same time that Pixie and her committee were talking about the housing. We've been talking about it for longer than that. So we formed a committee of five energetic people, and that was Pixie and Michelle Ture and Rick Bean, Bob Armstrong, and I.
Bob Anderson.
I'm Bob Anderson, thank you. The other Bob A, thank you.
Yeah.
In a very short period of time, we put together what we thought was a pretty good vision, and we wrote it down and made a proposal out of it. And it was basically to enable a community park that would be focused on passive recreation, that might have a gazebo, some barbecue grills, some benches, pathways to preserve the natural habitat that was already down there. The butterfly bushes and so forth, and we were pretty much gung-ho about that, and we thought, if we could just make that happen, that would be really cool. And about that time, we were faced with the river flood mitigation plan that was designing the plan, and the engineers got involved, and Natural Heritage, and the Army Corps of Engineers, and several other organizations that put their foot in the water, and really made it complicated. And from our point of view, we were kind of the tail that was looking to be wagged by the dog. So we've kind of held back now, waiting for something to happen. Now something has happened, and that place today screams for a park. If you just drive by there, you'll see it's been cleared off, and you can see the river. It's a beautiful place. We have the housing facility. I don't know where you are. We'll hear about it in a few minutes. And of course, the wastewater plan is posing a project there as well. But it still screams for a plan. Problem. From my perspective only, and I don't speak for the rest, we've run out of energy to do this. We've been working on it, or talking about it on this program for a couple of years, and I think none of us have the time nor the energy to put back into that to put it together. So that's the challenge that we face right now, is that I think the vision is good, the proposal is great, we just don't have an opportunity, we don't have the energy, the resources to put together and bring that about.
Well, perhaps in the future we can resurrect that.
Well, we're going to be addressing that.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. Good. That's the nice part about this meeting is to talk about it, because it just screams to be done. It really does. So.
What's your second hat?
Second one is the EMD, Emergency Management. I took over the Emergency Management Director position from Matt Boyden on July 1st. And have been working on that. We have been extremely successful in preventing disasters and emergencies, large-scale emergencies, from happening.
That's great.
We're good at that.
I trust that we will get appropriate credit for keeping Hurricane Matt at bay as well.
Yes.
But nevertheless, we have a really good emergency team of about 15 people. That includes the usual Ron and Kenny and Bob and the officials. But we also have a bunch of really super volunteers who are Mary is the chair of the head of the shelter committee. So the point is that as far as one could be at this point, we've got good people. We are trained. We meet. We talk about. We drill. We have a good manual, and we're we're ready for an emergency, as ready as one could be. The difficulty is, of course, when you don't have the emergencies, you don't have an opportunity to practice. And it's kind of like learning how to play the piano. If you don't have a concert as your goal, you never quite get to the level you'd like to. But we're there, and we can assure the people of Conway that we've got a pretty good emergency response team at work. Always looking for new volunteers, of course. A couple of things around that. We got a good grant last year from the federal government through MEMA, the Massachusetts Emergency Management Association. And just today, Tom and I completed our application for the current round of grants, looking to help pay for our emergency telephone system, communication system that we have, and to a couple of other things that we'd like to do as well. I think we're going to have a drill. This hasn't been a collective decision. I'm going to have a drill of the communication system, because we haven't drilled it in about 6 months since, and we need to do that now to clean it up. We get billed in December for each and every residence that is a part of that system. And I know some people have moved away, several people have passed away, and that needs to be cleaned up. And the only way you can do that is to run a drill with the telephone call that everyone who's on it is useful. So there is that issue, and we're going to meet in December with reps from the Massachusetts Emergency Management Association, known as MEMA, and the Western director is going to meet with us, drill some radio skills with us, and we're also going to learn from a couple of other people in the area how they have managed to be successful with their volunteer programs. I am personally involved with the regional emergency management association, and we're forming a new county level of resource that's above our local EOC, above our local group, so that we have well-coordinated functions between towns with additional resources brought in by the state if we need them.
Yeah, and that's run by the Franklin Regional Council of Governments.
That one, that is, but it's an offshoot of the REPC, so it should be up and running within the next year.
Terrific. Thank you, Dave, for all that great work. Go ahead, Mary.
Hey, so I'm Mary McClintock. I'm co-chair with Joe of the Planning Board. Dave's also on the Planning Board, Sue McFarland and Andy Jaffe also. Basically saying that what we do, thinking about when we're thinking about, well, what are we going to report on? We're thinking about, well, we work both proactively, planning, that's what our name is, planning, but also in response to Conway residents' concerns. And about half of our work right now is responding to concerns. In the proactive realm, one of the things we do is look at the zoning bylaws, which are really a living document that help people in Conway live together in our community. And so in terms of what are the rules, what do we want our neighbors to be doing or not doing with their property. Things that we've done in the past 6 months include meeting with the Energy Committee about a possible solar array sited on town and land north of the grammar school to supply most of the electricity needed by the school and other town municipal buildings, talking with them about that. Also, a major thing we did this summer and early fall was recognizing that if you talk about all the different things we're doing in town, there's this need for land. So we had two information gathering and sharing meetings with many town committees and boards to look at ways for groups to coordinate projects, including senior housing, safety complex, fire, police, and ambulance, highway garage, community leach field for the downtown area, and parks. Basically, what we came up with is it looks like we need about 25 to 35 acres in multiple parcels to meet these needs, not including open space for agricultural needs. And really encouraging boards to work cooperatively to identify parcels for town use. one of the things that we did when the Sheehan properties up on Maple Street became available, we're just going in the market, we looked at those as possibilities. What, you know, are there private lands that could be for sale, that could be useful for one of these town needs? It's challenging because we don't move swiftly. As Joe mentioned, there was a 50-acre parcel up there that, you know, it was like, well, is there part of that that could be useful for something? And it sold within a week. So that's part of the reason why it's helpful for people to be communicating and knowing what's going on. One of the things we're doing right now is reviewing zoning bylaws related to setback of structures from property lines. So say this is a piece of property, and you have your house here, and you want to put a solar array over here. How close to your neighbor's line can it be? That's one of the things we're looking at right now, is particularly for any sort of accessory uses. Right now, there's a certain setback, but should solar have a different one? That's something we're looking at. One of the things the planning board does is deal with applications for special permits. We've done recently issued a special permit for the French's Garage on a grandfathered lot. Right now, there's a special permit application to create an accessory apartment. And one of the things that we're doing is, so that there's a whole process for doing special permits, and there's a whole process for a number of the things we do, like revising the zoning bylaws. We're right now developing written procedures for that. I don't know how many people realize that the planning board is pretty new as its own entity. It used to be part of the select board. The select board and the planning board were sort of all one thing. And so now, sort of getting what are our procedures more clear as a planning board. We're also currently responding to a complaint by a neighbor about potentially excessive excavation on a lot. We get, you know, requests for, well, you look into this, we think this person is violating this zoning bylaw. So we're pursuing that. We also had some input from the Franklin Regional Council of Governments on what they call the fluvial erosion hazard of the South River and all of the rivers in town. And that's what's the possibility of erosion, and how could that impact things in, you know, certain kinds of rain. So they did this whole fancy study, and we learned from them about that.
What? Gotta have water first.
Right. In the drought year, not such a big thing right now. And that's most of it. If there's questions.
Mary, is there any guidance in the state's new Municipal Modernization Act that would help us streamline some permitting?
I haven't heard about it.
I peruse it. I wouldn't say I understand it yet, but it doesn't look like there's a lot of planning stuff in there. There was a potential to rewrite the Zoning Act, which has been on the table for the last 10 years. I understand that hasn't passed either. So that would totally revamp our zoning state regulation.
There are many articles and elements of that act that will streamline procedures at our level. So if there's anything in there that can help us, We should look at it.
Right. I mean, right now the special permit process is based on state law. So right, it would be, if that got changed, then that would impact special permit process. Yeah. And zoning, well, you know, what part of zoning or not part of zoning. But I'm not
sure. John, I don't remember any zoning changes in that.
Okay.
Municipal law. If you see any, let me know.
Okay.
I did look at it.
If you have any questions about our zoning bylaws, this is the expert right here. This is the guru of all zoning bylaw questions. Well, I'm like trying to learn.
I'm trying to teach her, but yeah.
I'm a quick study, but not that quick.
She's a good student. So now that everything else is covered, I'm going to do the wastewater, or you call it the sewer commission?
The sewer rats.
The members are Dave Chichester, Marie Eichen, who's also on the Board of Health, Michelle Novak, and myself. At the last annual town meeting, we presented an abbreviated version of our feasibility study. I took out 3/4 of the slides because it was a really cranky audience and it was late at night. So we did the short version. Unfortunately, we didn't get a lot of feedback. The only one I got that I really enjoyed was someone came up to me and said, if you had done the highway garage, we'd be in that new building by now. So I don't know if that was really true or not, but it was nice to hear. This summer, we initiated a household income survey for the downtown business area. Unfortunately, to date, we have only had 35% of the people respond. We need 85% to qualify for these low-interest loans. The good news is the average household income that's been reported is around $55,000, so the income levels are probably lower than I had expected. I mean, they're well below what we need to qualify, but we cannot get the responses. Some of us did a phone calling one night, and we got an earful from a couple of people. Some people just don't want to give out personal information.
Part of your survey alert those people that if we got a good response, we would qualify for some grants?
We've tried to tell people that, but it hasn't worked with some of the people we've talked to. They're just opposed to big government. And
sure.
They're not interested in divulging their incomes or anything like that.
And I'll note that the information, if I'm correct, doesn't come back to the committee, right?
We don't. It's protected information.
Was it going to go to the Regional Housing Authority?
It goes to RCAP.
Oh, okay. All right. So it wouldn't even come people
all down. All they tell us is who didn't respond and what the average has been reported.
When it's submitted, do their names have to stay on the submission? Is there some way their identity can be crossed off? That might
sure. I don't know if they can do that. It was mailed out, you know, to the street. I think the only thing they actually put on is the street address, but you could find their name to the street address. We need to know where they're reporting from. So the street address, we don't get the information.
Yeah.
We have a list of the people who have and have not responded and what the average has been reported. That's the only thing we have to work with. So we're trying to figure out what the message is. Are people trying to tell us they're not interested? Or are they just too lazy to fill out the forms? Or, you know, we call people, they say, well, oh, I lost it, I misplaced it, or could you send me another one? Or, I did some house calling, talked to some people, you know, some one-on-ones to try to get them to fill out their forms. It did work a little bit, but it's not enough. We did talk with a consultant, and he basically said he thought we'd done as much advertising as we could, and we probably should just let it go fallow for a while and see what happens. The committee also visited two small subsurface treatment facilities, some people call them leach fields. We went to South Hadley to see a condo association that's right off of Route 116. There's a facility there that serves over 100 condo units. So it's representative of what we would do in Conway. We also took a trip to Hillsdale, New York. They have a small Center Village district that's being served by one of these treatment systems. They have like 150 businesses and homes in the center of town. Unfortunately, it's perfectly flat. The river's about a mile away. So they were able to take all the waste from the center of town, put it through a 3-inch pipe about a half a mile down to the treatment plant. You know, and there's hardly anything there, but they had nice, flat, perfectly accessible land. We have decided to proceed with the engineering firm selection to go out for design and bid package preparation. We're working through the FERCOG, through Andrea Woods. What we're hoping to do, we have enough money to go out to bid for an engineering firm. So we would like to come back, assuming we successfully find an engineer and get bids to come back to town meeting and say, this is what we need to design the system for the town. Sort of like what we did with the highway garage, you did it in steps. If we're successful and if town ends up needing a special town meeting, we might be able to ask for the money before annual town meeting. If we were to get it in January, we might have the study done before next annual town meeting in May. We could be back with the, you know, bids for an actual system. Depends on whether the citizens are ready to put money up for the engineering study at this point. We continue to hear about failing septic systems and dry water well. Jack Gates was just talking about that. Sue McFarland on our planning board's well has gone dry, and she said there are three or four people, and you probably know this already, that the shallow wells seem to be drying up in towns. And we still do have occasional septic systems failure. That's it for us, I guess.
Thank you, Joe. Peter?
Yeah, Pete Zale, I chair the Community Preservation Committee. What we do is really kind of screen requests for expenditure of CPA money and do some basic accounting. So a lot of this is just going to be numbers. But for fiscal year 16, we collected a little over $75,000 from the tax base. We collected a little over $72,000 in national state funds. We qualify for the maximum reimbursement match from the state. Doesn't mean we always get it, because it depends on how much money the state has to allocate. But so far, so good. We got about $16,500 in interest. So our total income for fiscal year 16 is about $164,000, give or take. In fiscal 16, we spent about $11,400 on a senior housing feasibility study. That leaves about $4,600 of the previously allocated and voted for $22,000 at town meeting approved. And I should mention that this committee doesn't have the power to just allocate money. It only has the power to recommend something to the town meeting. The town has to allocate. We spent, in fiscal year 16, we spent about $1,200 on salt grass or silt stilt grass removal, and $600 to clean up on a ball field improvements. As of 6:30, the end of the fiscal year, our balance was close to $506,000. About $124,000 of that, a little over that, has been voted to projects and not yet spent. So there's $381,391 available. Of that, almost $59,000 is reserved for open space spending. About $86,000 is reserved for housing, and about $38,000 is reserved for historical preservation. Those sums have to be spent for those purposes, but there's very close to $200,000 of unreserved balance, which can be spent on any of those three categories. And we spent about $6,000 on the Frontier tennis courts last year. I mentioned the $11,400 for the senior housing feasibility. And so far this year, we've spent $100,000 on the South River restoration, and another $1,800 in stilt grass control. So we're in pretty good shape. I think the only thing we've got that's ongoing might be preservation of historic assessor records. I don't know if you guys are still doing that.
I think we are.
Yeah. other than that, we're pretty much done. As far as upcoming stuff, I've kind of been tickled by the Tibetan organization that owns the old grammar school, looking for help restoring their roof. That's going to be a little tricky because we have to show public interest. And I believe the trustees of the reservation are going to be looking for something. Probably, I don't know why, but I suspect it's in relation to the Bullet Reservation. I guess they own about 50 acres of county. So that's the only thing I've got on the horizon. It's been a quiet year, and that's good. It means we're just accumulating money. The assessors have estimated, by the way, that we'll pick up about $86,000 in taxes for fiscal year 2017, which could mean another match from the state of about $80,000 if we get the max.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah, that CPA always does a great job.
I think it's a tremendous resource to have in our pocket. You know, and we can do things that we can't. We don't have to go to the tax rolls to get.
Exactly. Yeah.
I mean, I might suggest, by the way, that we we're wanting towards the bathrooms in this building, which are historic.
Historic, right.
So you're actively looking for people to submit proposals, right? Or
yes.
Ideas? I believe the committee can put forward proposals.
We can put forward our own proposals, or we will, more than happy to listen to other proposals. And what we are mandated to do is annually have an open meeting where we ask for proposals.
And about when is that?
I believe we did that in April of this year.
So right before town meeting?
It's not, that was not great timing. I think probably we need to do it about now in order to get things going if anybody has something, on the top.
Mm-hmm. Great. Thank you, Peter.
Sure.
Jack.
Jack Gates, I'm chairman of the Conservation Commission. I think I'd start out by what a difference a year makes, because this year our time has been dramatically increased on solar and dramatically decreased on oil pipelines. So shows how things can change. What I like to do every year is just briefly explain what we do, because I think it's foreign to still a lot of people. We're really a regulatory body that is charged with administration of the Wetlands Act, which is a state statute, and the Rivers Act, which is another state statute dealing with wetlands or rivers and protection of them in an environmental sense. And then there's a whole series of regulations that have been adopted under those two statutes. And we're the local body that administers those regulations. And that ranges from everything from literally every building permit in town we have to do a site visit to confirm the location is not within a wetland or a resource area that is regulated. We have to hold hearings on any application of a homeowner or landowner that wants to do a project that is within a resource area, or to determine they're not within it. It's something that I'm pleased about, that at least since I've been on the commission, we really haven't told anyone, no, you cannot do the project that you want to do. Often we have to work with the individual to maybe modify locations of the project or how the project's done, so it's done in a sensitive manner to the environment that we're trying to regulate. And by the way, yes, solar does come under the preview of the Wetlands and the River Act. You can't. It's just like any other building process. It's not exempt because it's got a beneficial end game, if you will. So that's what we do. So it's not a very glamorous job at times. It's really meat and potatoes kind of work, and it's a lot of legwork because of all the site visits that go on. I've gotten to see parts of town that I didn't know existed even after being here 4 years. But the problem we're having right now is probably like other boards. We're supposed to have 5 members. Since I've been on, we've only had 4 members. Can't fill the 5th spot. One of the 4 is still on but can no longer come to meetings. So we're really functioning on 3 people. We need a quorum of 3 in order to officially act. And the reason I think that's important, and we've tried to get the word out, but we don't get anybody that wants to come in. When they find out it's a regulatory body, they think of environmental work as, I think, something more glamorous than looking at all these regulations. The difficulty is, and this goes to the cost, we probably have one of the smallest budgets in town. The history of the statute, when it was passed, it's a state statute, and it came in through the state, and the state wanted to regulate all of these two acts through the Mass Department of Environmental Protection, a state agency. The citizens of the towns didn't want another state agency overlooking how they ran their towns, So the compromise in the legislation when it was created was very unique. It created local conservation commissions that were the first line of making the interpretation of the regulations for each town. So each town puts their own citizens in the position of interpreting, and a lot of the statute is interpretive. So it's very important to know your town. And our interpretation holds weight with the state unless it's completely bogus. And so we get to talk to our own citizens and come up with our own determinations. And if we cannot function as a commission, the state steps in. And the closest state person is in Springfield, number one. Number two, there's been a floater put out to me through COG to eliminate the local CONCOMs and make it a Council on Government paid position. So it would become like the building inspector, for example. And while that can probably be more efficient, the problem with that is going to be, number one, it's going to change the budget significantly. Like I said, we have very little budget that we do. And the fees that people pay for the permit pay for the advertising and things like that. So we almost don't even spend our budget that we have. Whereas if it gets into the Council on Government, in my mind, two things are going to happen. You are going to have a budget line item. And second, you're going to lose the citizens' eyes on the ground in terms of interpreting the regulations, or you have the potential for doing that. If we make a real bad mistake, the state tells us that, you know, that was bad and we're going to overrule you, which they've only done one time, and actually they did it where we didn't want something to happen and they said it could happen. But that's only been once, and we've probably been there 6 years or so now doing this. So staffing is important, and I know it is with every committee, and I don't know the solution to that issue, but we really could use at least one more person, because with just three of us doing the work, especially when you understand we have to look at all the building permits, it starts to be a full-time job. Two of us are retired, or semi-retired anyways, and so we're able to do some of that. One, you know, is full-time employed and has a family. So it's really hard to get to all of these site visits that we have to do before we can hold the hearings on the matters. It's really, to me, an important commission in that we get to have our own people determining what's a wetland, what's a resource, what makes sense for Conway. Conway is very unique. We have a lot of water in Conway and a lot of resources that are really precious, but also a lot of people that want to try to use their land. So it's a real good balancing act, if you will. So my only concern is staffing, to be honest.
Did you put anything in the visitor, Jack?
We've been posting it online.
We have it online.
Oh yeah.
I don't know that I've put it in the visitor.
Maybe that might reach some people.
I do get people that, you know, read and are interested, but they're not aware that it's a regulatory board, that we have a book of regulations that are this thick, and that's the first thing I give people if they come on the commission. And it's very dry reading, believe me. And it's not actually easy regulations either. Whoever wrote these did their best to make it difficult.
Some lawyer wrote them.
Yeah. I don't know. they're very convoluted, and they're what you think should be in the river section is over here in the definition section. So it gets to be a little confusing to try to explain all of that to the homeowners that are trying to do their projects, which we try to do. I think there's only three times I think homeowners have tried to gimmick the system in the many, so it's a minute number of people. Everybody's been really great to work with in terms of homeowners and stuff. So that's what we do, what we have for a commission. Probably could use one or two more people, like most of the commissions.
Great. Thank you, Jack.
Along those lines, we are short of associate member, I didn't mention that. So we also could use a sixth member.
This is, you know, I talk to towns all over the state, and believe me, our problem with volunteerism is not unique. It's all over. It's a real problem, especially for the smaller towns.
When I was doing the community development strategy, which is now completed and submitted, I found out that there are roughly 250 volunteer positions that we have in town. And we have roughly 150 people filling those 250 positions. So the average person is on 1.6 committees. So probably many people here exceed that, some considerably, I know. But that's the order of magnitude that it takes for the town to run the way it should. So it's tremendous that we have that many people involved. And it's just another little bit is always hard to get.
Ron?
Ron Sweet, Highway Department. We got several projects that we're working on right now. We're getting ready to do East Guinea Road, a full reclamation of the blacktop and repaving. That'll probably happen in the spring. Going through the drainage now, checking and seeing what we have to do before we do that project. Also checking into trying to preserve South Ashfield and Williamsburg Road before it gets too bad and end up losing all the money that the federal government put in that road. So I'm looking into, you know, what our options in that. Delaware Ave, we've got an engineer working on the slope problem over there by Orchard Equipment. Hopefully FEMA comes through with that, helping us on that.
We're going to get something put up to keep people from falling over the edge. Mm-hmm. It might be more visual than physical at first, but just don't fall over the edge, please.
Mm-hmm. And plan is for Baptist Hill, Upper Baptist Hill, and Cemetery Hill of doing a repave on that. Hoping we're running into a little problem with drainage on that road, trying to figure out what's there for drainage. Don't want to put some expensive money down on blacktop and then have to tear it up afterwards. So I'm trying real hard to figure out what's going on there with the drainage. Bridge on North Poland Road, the problem bridge that we have. Working with an engineer right now. Hopefully we'll have some results from, or cost estimate from him this week, so we can move forward to find out what kind of money we're looking at to repair the bridge. Doesn't sound like this Mass DOT is going to be of much help in helping us keep that bridge open for a while, so working on that. With some other drainage issues that we're working on hopefully soon on Hoosick Road and Orchard Street. So we got plenty of things that we're going on. Been doing some graveling on some of the dirt roads. Just trying to keep things going.
Is the state's small bridge project going to help us in any way?
We don't really have, as far as I know at this point, we don't have any issues with any of our under 20-foot bridges that are any dire need of anything at this time, so.
Do you have any inside word on how much snow we're going to get this winter?
I'll tell you.
That's a little late, though, Ron.
It'll be accurate, yeah.
Thanks, Ron. Janet?
I am now, for the last couple of months, I've been chairman of the Open Space Committee, and one of our recent main focus has actually been the River Bend meadow. And primarily the perimeter of it, looking at invasive plants and looking at potentially how those can be managed, and then what could be done from an open space, natural resource perspective, was primarily the perimeter, which you really can't do much with it anyway. And in this regard, we were, with the town's approval, and Tom Hutchinson ID'd some money that was just for the implementation of the open space plan, open space implementation plan that the town has. We hired naturalist Lori Sanders, and we've been working with her, well, and also FERCOG and some of the contractors, particularly on the treatment of the invasives. Anybody's looked at it all around that property during the preparation, and the CONCOM too, is preparation for the site plan. Anyway, she's going to present a plan, a proposed plan for park, meadow, town use. At the planning board, their November 17th meeting here in this room, beginning at 7 p.m. And we would like as many, you know, people to come, and you know, she'll be making a presentation and a lot of discussion, question and answers. So that's been exciting. You know, I don't know if everybody knows this floodplain project is done for now, and there's a retaining basin where the water's supposed to go in the floodplain. And we're concerned with FERCOG that integrity of that be maintained, you know, the perimeters, and we're going to get some recommendations of management of it. At the same time that the select board just approved the replanting of that management of the center areas for hayfield. And so, you know, it's going to be very nice looking, but we do have to make sure that over time, you know, it doesn't get eroded and get inched up on too much, that basin that, you know, over $300,000 has been spent on. And we are also the overseer for the silt grass removal project, which has finished its third and final year. They've had, Michelle's not here tonight, they've had a lot of success in removing, it's just this terrible invasive that nobody ever wants to see spread, kill everything. So they've had a lot of success in some areas, and then they've discovered some more in other areas. And so there may be, as with most of these nasty invasive, you need to keep up with it to a certain extent over a number of years. So they may be coming back for some small continuing work with that. We did have, in September, we had a workshop, a demonstration on taking care of your own invasive plants, and we used it with CONCOM's tacit approval on the riverbed property, and had a big turnout, but like 25 people more than we thought. So there is some interest in learning how to deal in
that. That's a good program.
It was, thank you, Jack. Thank you. We're going to be looking to develop maybe some other recommendations on some of the other towns' open spaces in terms of management and improving any habitat and on that, in that regard.
Great. Thank you, Janet.
Janet, I had a question. With the flood mitigation project, there was a plan to put weirs in the river.
Yes.
Where's that stand?
Well, those are
there. I haven't. Are they there? Because I haven't walked down there to see. They are. And how many did they end up putting in?
Two.
That's all.
There was one. Well, one landowner.
Well, there was one that was taken out.
There was supposed to be four originally, I believe, and then three.
Okay.
Went
so
in.
It's. Okay.
And then there's the root plots that are in as well, that were embedded into the river bottom.
Gotcha.
Okay. Just a moment to remind folks that this was a sort of priority number two, or the selection after this river mitigation, the first fluvial geomorphology study of the whole length of the river and all the erosions. It's a very elaborate, very impressive thing we've got online at the Friends of the South River. And there were like five top priorities in terms of what would make the most impact in reducing the erosion. And we, Joe was, and John were very active, and we picked this one because it was town owned land. But there were three or four, I mean, there's a whole a long list. But there were three or four really important projects. And I, just because it's dry this year, it doesn't mean that, you know, more floods aren't coming, and that the erosion, even when it's not flooding, I mean, the erosion continues to. So that's something that maybe the planning board would address, or that the town needs to keep in mind. And I mean, luckily, I think this is a good use of CPA money for some of those things. Plus, there's mention, you know, that the other governments paid for most of this project, and probably would for others.
On that same note, I believe Kimberly is trying to get more money from ERCOT,
of course,
to do additional work. Yeah. I don't know if she'll be. As you said, that was the number two spot. The number one is
yes,
sort of behind us.
That, that is important, a very important number one, right behind us.
Yes.
The retaining wall that you.
Yeah.
Yes. Retaining wall.
I don't know if, have you heard if Kimberly's was able to get more money?
I know she's working on it, but I'll find out probably tomorrow because I'll be up there for a meeting. So
just I'll encourage her because I think it is really important to the town, right? And a lot of people feel that way.
Yeah. Thank you, Janet. We'll move to the back, Julie.
Oh, sure. So Julie Petty, this hat is the cultural council hat. And I'm reporting mostly for Erica Works and Polly Byers, who are co-chairs. The Cultural Council, we're volunteers. We administer a grant program funded by the Mass Cultural Council. Our funds benefit programs supporting events in the arts, humanities, and natural sciences. Our goal is to fund programs and events that provide citizens of Conway with affordable entertainment, education, and opportunities for creative growth. Our priority is to fund programs that include local artists, individuals, and groups, and that directly benefit Conway. This past year, we awarded a total of $4,851 to 18 grantees, and we had 27 proposals. Some highlights were two artist programs at the Field Memorial Library, an event at Conway Grammar School, a music proposal from the Festival of the Hills Committee, and free ukulele lessons at the Field Memorial Library. This coming year, we are pretty excited to see what's in our package because it's the 250th year. We're hoping to see some fun proposals. Also, this grant year, which we'll have a meeting to fund next year's grants in November, will be all of the grant proposals will be submitted online, and we'll be reviewing and then posting our results online as well.
Expecting the funding to be equal to last year, Julie?
We don't know. Okay. It's a formula determined by the state, and it's per capita based, and it fluctuates, so we don't know. But we, I mean, that's something that we're about to find out.
Great.
So,
thank you, Julie. Any questions for Julie? No. Okay, Bryce.
Did you have another? I thought you had two. You also?
What was that?
Okay. Hi, I'm Bryce Hereford, a member of the Conway Energy Committee, along with Sue Braves, Peter Martin, and Peter Rosnick. We had a busy year this year. I'll just go right through the programs. We run the Cozy Home Program, which is Conway's collaboration with Community Action, which is now in its third year. And it offers new windows, doors, refrigerator replacements, new wall, attic, and basement insulation, as well as new LED light bulbs, new efficient shower heads, everything. Smart power strips, kitchen aerators, and mini-split zoning to qualifying residents, free of charge. It is our hope in Community Actions that eventually we'll also be able to include solar installation and or an electricity sharing program, which leads me into the next project, which is proposal for a large-scale solar farm up by the school for 250 kilowatts that we are right now in the planning stages with an organization out of Boston called New Ecology. In fact, tomorrow night, we're having a meeting with them, this as well as hopefully being joined with us by the Board of Selectmen and the Planning Board. If any of you have gone by down 116 past Sunderland Grammar and you've seen that solar farm in there, that's 300 kilowatts. We're looking at 250, give you an idea of the scale. One of the funniest things is that the gentleman running that project was David Smith, who graduated from Conway Grammar a number of years ago, and he told me, would you guys get on the stick? Because he doesn't want to have to travel too far to do his next job. So moving on, we're in the middle of the town hall retrofit, and due to Mass Historical Commission's review, we have redirected the project to include work on the town garage using the same funding source so we won't lose any of the funding and keep it moving forward. So far, $27,000 has been expended with a balance of $98,000 for these projects before we apply for a new grant. We're looking for other areas where we can reduce our expenditure in electricity. Streetlights are a target, and we're working with the town public safety officials to determine which of the 66 streetlights in town can be turned off completely and which ones that we can have on a timer to shut off earlier. We're not sure if we can have these lights switched to low-powered LEDs, but that's something that we'd like to pursue to reduce the electricity charge, which is last year was $7,000 for streetlights. We're looking at reducing the municipal electricity costs through using electricity brokers, which is something a number of the towns are doing. And so far, two of the brokers that we've contacted, Hampshire Electric through Hampshire Cog, and Constellation have come in with rates that are above what we're currently paying. So they indicated that that their higher rates takes into account the higher rates that we'll be paying in the winter. A third consultant, Bay State Consultant, said that we really need to have more load. We have to spend more electricity to have a large enough load to really make any significant energy savings. So right now I'm waiting to see what the Eversource winter rates are going to be to see if in fact we would save much money. But we're paying less than either of them could give us. Also, the town is paying less for their electricity than Conway Grammar, which is a part of Region 38, is also part of a brokerage program. So go figure. Working with the UMass Clean Energy Extension, who has internships to help communities with their Green Communities grants and reports and Mass Energy Insight. And I'm working with them to update the Mass Energy Insight website as well as our annual Green Communities reports. Almost done. This year, as you know, we participated with Shelburne and Colerain in the solarization program through the Mass Clean Energy Center. This program will conclude at the end of October. I want to thank you all for your participation and encouragement. The latest numbers for all three towns are there were a total of 432 site visits. There were 60 contracts signed for over 400 kilowatts of photovoltaic panels. And there are 102 proposals still open for the program, and those total 744 kilowatts. If all these contracts come in, this program will have netted over 1 megawatt, which is a significant milestone. For Conway alone, because I know it's what we all care about, there are 164 site visits, there are 14 contracts signed for 101 kilowatts, and 30 proposals still outstanding for potential 236 kilowatts. If all the Conway proposals come in, it could be a combined total of 337 kilowatts. To let you know, Shelburne is eating our dust, and we're neck and neck with Colerain to have the most PV. So if any of you are thinking about it or going on the fence, come on in. And the last thing we're doing is a Conway residential electrical aggregation program, which basically is we pool all the residents who buy in and then go out on the market and get inexpensive, hopefully inexpensive energy for us all. And that's what we've been doing for people. We, as well as others, would welcome any volunteers. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bryce. I know the Energy Committee has been working extremely hard on many projects, and I'm sure you're probably going to be spending a lot of time with Jack.
Yes.
Right, Jack?
He must be visiting the sites already.
That's right.
I see a lot of them, yes.
Yep. I appreciate your participation.
And let's come up to Ellen Fixie.
I'm Ellen Lamaster. I'm a member of the Housing Committee.
Okay, I'm Pixie Holbrook, chair of the Housing Committee, and our committee is Donna Crabtree and Nelson Shiflett, Ellen and Martha Conan. And the job we've had to do is find land. That's the job of all any area hill towns looking, and people in the valley looking to do this kind of project. And we're finding it to be a very arduous slog. We have used West Hampton Woods a lot as our template. It took them 20 years to find a piece of land. I think we're in year 11 or 12 at this point. Right from the beginning, town-owned land is the preference. It's the way we're going to attract a developer for them to say this is going to be viable. So, as you know, we've been laser-focused on the piece of land at the beginning of Shelburne Falls Road. And with the money that we got from CPA, the recommendation, we had a very, very fine report from them that synthesized the results of the survey, which show a good, solid 24% of the people surveyed out of close to 100 are highly interested in this project. But the conclusion was that particular site, when it had been cut site-specific, is that it's got a very high price for this specialized fill that has to be brought in. And when you build on top of fill, the fill cannot have any organic matter. So it's some type of highly pulverized dirt, stone. And that is estimated at possibly $600,000. So we've gone from a free piece of land to one that could cost us $600,000. Is that going to be a deterrent to a developer? We think it's highly likely it could. So we started to turn our attention to, how could we get that kind of money? We did have for a while a quiet promise from a private benefactor, and that person is not able to be that generous, which we certainly appreciated their thought. So it's making us pause to reflect. We had given ourselves till January to say, let's stay focused on this piece. If we can't come up with a solution, then it's time to turn another direction. So then back in the summer, we got together as part of the group with the planning group, recognizing that there are a number of us need significant land. And we don't even need a lot. We think 3 acres is all that we need. So out of that came, how about the Sheehan land? How about the Tibetan Center? How about the John Harris land on Shelburne Falls Road? And so we've sort of been spending some of our energy around those ideas. But that puts us in a bind. We don't understand the process, because let's say we decide on a piece of land that's privately owned and we'd have to purchase. All of those are significantly less than $600,000. How do we do that? We go to the town and say, do you trust us to go forward with this piece? I'd like to be able to say, here's a conceptual design of what this would look like, but how long is that piece of land going to stay for sale? So we're feeling we could use some cheerleading, is what we could use. We're feeling kind of stymied right now. It feels good to work as a town group looking for land for each other. We talked, I think, near the end of the last planning board meeting of advertising. Is there some landowner here in town that would come forward? Obviously, we've all thought that being in the center of town had its advantages, but it's not being in the center of town that's priority. It's creating a community where seniors age in place feeling safe. and not feeling isolated. Again, going back to West Hampton Woods, they're nowhere near their center of town. They have even less in the center of their town. But they've found a, you know, I think it's like a, maybe a 10-acre, would you say, maybe even more, flat piece of land, and they put in 8 units, and it was so popular with just people from West Hampton, they added another 8. They're all filled with a waiting list. So the need is there. And then we just got a, I forgot what it's called, but it's from the Franklin County, agencies, housing agencies, which substantiates this enormous need all through the Hilltowns. Enormous. I think I've said before, they call it the silver tsunami. We have to find places for people. They don't want to leave. And even if they wanted to leave, you can't just go to Greenfield. You just can't go to Northampton. Those places have long, long waiting lists too. It's a really, it's going to be a crisis. And we're watching Sunderland and South Deerfield, how they're proceeding. We met with Sunderland maybe last year or two as a group. Wendell came, Waitley, a whole bunch of us, sort of brainstorming with each other. At that point, they were all looking to us to see what was going on. Sunderland was given a historic home on their main street with some land in the back, and they're scratching their heads because historic homes aren't really helpful, you know, to put senior housing in, so they're trying to figure out what to do. And then Deerfield, as we all have seen, that they've got a developer who's already got a piece of land, and they're moving ahead with getting approval from the town, and that has, you know, it's controversial for them.
Sure.
So we're kind of feeling a little stymied. I don't want to lose the energy of some of these really great people on my committee. Some have said, if I don't have something to bite into, I don't think I'm going to stay here. I'm here to be active and be engaged, and we're just feeling kind of stuck right now. So with that, I, you know, like I said, I'm still committed.
On the process issue,
yeah.
Get together with Tom.
Okay.
He's got some pointers.
Excellent.
For you.
Excellent. Okay, thank you.
And thank you for your work.
Pixie, did you look at the Matus property?
Which one?
The Matus property.
I don't know that one. What is it?
Wade Road. We've been getting a lot of inquiries.
The 20 acres?
This is 40 acres, and he's trying to divide the land. He's been asking us to do his work and divide his property for him.
You mean the one just past the Beaver? Beaver Lodge?
Yeah, on the right-hand side.
Yeah. We contacted them probably a good 6 months ago when they had the 10 acres. And the critical piece is we have to perk for 12 units. So we contacted their engineer. Right. They contacted their engineer. It perks for 2. That piece perks for 2. It's solid ledge and it's wet, which was stunning to me. I said, oh, look at that. Big field, solar, easy access.
It's the same site. This is a 45-acre piece, all in one piece.
Well, again, do they have for sale signs there?
Yes. I don't see anything posted here.
I can talk to you after
the reason.
Ron, do you know which one I mean?
There's 2 signs there.
Yeah.
It seems to me for what might be suitable, you may have to, you know, zero in and have other people who know people zero in before this for sale signs go on there, because it does take time. But then if it really looks good,
right,
you know, a special town meeting can be called.
Yep.
You know, it's... Yep. Obviously, this, you know, not the way normal town business
right.
works. It's something more. So, so in this case, I mean, if just because he's got 45 acres, I mean, if these folks can
so
help you,
heard
if you
about
want 10 or less,
Joe,
or
I heard
10, the
and
park.
Then they went to 20. So I don't know what.
This is one piece, 45 acres. The first question he asked of the planning board is how many houses can I put up, and we begged off on that one. Then he came back and said, well, if I do a 10-acre and a 45, what's my tax rate going to be? And we begged off on that one. But
all right. Yeah, it's the same one. M-A-D-D-I-S, right?
M-A-D-D-I-S.
M-A-T-U-S.
M-A-T-U-S.
So it sounds like he's open to some flexible...
He's looking at his land.
10 years ago.
No, I don't think it's outside.
Yeah, I didn't see it posted here.
If any of you know, it's right before where the houses start on Waitley Road, the second group.
Kevin Williams is the real estate right now.
Right.
The snowmobile trail, I think, goes up through the property.
It does. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the sign is Kevin Williams.
Yep.
Yep.
across from. Try them again.
It would be a great place, you could watch the heron nests right across.
Oh, I know. But again, I asked them when it was 10 acres, and they said it perked for two. So maybe the 45 perks for more. I don't know. I'll look into it.
Thank you, Chris. Mark?
I'm Mark Silverman, and I'm representing the Zoning Board of Appeals. This actually, the Zoning Board of Appeals is, like Mary was saying, for the planning board, is responsive, and that's it. And Lee Wickham drafted me, which really means guilted me into being part of it, about 10 years ago. And she said, you get just a small number of requests for variances, and boy, was she right. So in those 10 years, it's been 5 of them. So my main problem is learning how to conduct, as John knows, a hearing, because they don't get much practice that way. So we were actually, after about 3 years ago, Lee decided it was time to retire, and then the other person also did, so suddenly I was all by myself, which is not a quorum. And John graciously offered to join, and we now have 3. But in the whole time John's been doing this with me, we've had 1 hearing.
And it's been a good hearing, though.
Really well done. Really well done.
Site visit, everything was great. It was great. You did a great job on that.
That's so John gets out of it by complimenting. So there's not much to say, because it's really just, it's as people need us, that's our responsibility.
And what kinds of things come before a zoning board of appeals?
Well, you're working on the zoning board.
That's a trick question.
Well, this is explaining to everybody.
It's really using the zoning bylaws to decide after a building permit has been denied whether there are extenuating circumstances that can grant a variance, which is really flexibility in the zoning laws. And so there, you know, certainly rules have to be followed to make sure that a variance is granted in good faith, but at the same time, it becomes very straightforward. The thing that terrified me soon after I joined it was that the Montague Center School was, the school system, Gil Montague, closed the school, and suddenly the village of Montague was faced with what to do with the school. And it was really controversial. As people want, they really wanted to preserve their school, and they wanted to keep a developer from doing what he wanted to do. And it's something where I can't imagine being equipped to be able to make decisions like that and conduct that kind of hearing. So here we're not faced with anything like that, unfortunately.
We can change the bylaw and make you busy.
Sure. I felt kind of guilty when you're sitting there examining the bylaws and changing them and updating them, and I don't have to do anything.
So, you come out of the social network.
I will note that in many towns, the Zoning Board of Appeals does both variances and special permits. And in Conway, the Planning Board does special permits along with stewardship of the bylaws themselves. So this is a little bit of a special case, but it does light schedule.
35 years that I've been involved with town, I think we've had 3 special permits, so wow. We're not far behind as far as special permits. We've had a run this year. We've had two. Friendship, and now the second one. But we went dry for at least 10 years in a row. No.
So Mark, quiet is good, so we're okay.
Right.
Thank you, Mark. Heidi, what do you have for us?
I'm one of those people here tonight with many hats. So I'll start with Parks, Recs, and Trails. So as many of you know, we opened our ball field this year. In May, we had an opening ceremony along with the baseball games throughout the day, which was very successful. We had a bunch of parent volunteers who rebuilt the dugouts, since we did not pass that at our special town meeting to rebuild them out of masonry. We kind of refurbished what was there with some new siding, replaced rotted timbers, stuff like that. All with donated material by Integrity Development and Construction.
Who is Integrity Development?
Her name is Anna Cook, and she has a business partner named Heidi Flanders. we donated the materials. We do construction, so obviously it's part of our plethora of things. So, let's see, we also, we had Michael Mandol, I hope I said that right, created a historic Conway State Forest map for public use. So that's available, I think you can go on the website and find out where you can get that. I even have them in the town office, I'm not sure. We, down at the grammar school, we built a new trail that's been being used by all of the students weekly now at this point. They have a new running club that uses the trail, and that was done with a bunch of volunteers on one Saturday. We went down and cleared some trails down there, so feel free to go down and use the new trail, it's really nice. Watch out for poison ivy. It's my one. We at town meeting approved to join forces with Conway Youth Sports, so we joined forces with them, and we're still trying to work out the kinks of who does what there. Conway Youth Sports, as you know, in the last couple of years, it was manned by one person, and when he stepped down, we've had a couple of people step up to take the realm of that, but they have now come on with Parks and Rec, so we're trying to establish kind of manual, per se, of how that's going to work. Let's see, we continued to provide the town with the ice rink for winter ice skating. I don't know if any of you have tried that out yet, but it's a really nice feature we've had. We are going to try to continue to do that this year. Unfortunately, the chair of our committee stepped down, and he really pursued the ice skating because that was his thing. So we're looking for volunteers if anybody is interested in setup, takedown, or maintenance. Maintenance being the key one. It's a really tricky thing to maintain. So let us know if you're interested. We help fund senior yoga with CPA as well. So, and I've heard that it's great success, and there's quite a few people who attend it. So if any, you know, if you haven't, go ahead. We had a little issue with the baseball dirt on the baseball field, which some of you may have heard about, others may not have. Basically, the soil that was put in is like concrete. And so when children slide on it, they get hurt. So we basically went in.
Concrete baseball field.
Right, a concrete ball field, yeah. It's never going to go away, no. It apparently grows weeds, though. So we've gone in with some volunteer tractors from town. We brought in some extra dirt, mixed that in, or well, sand, I guess it was technically, and mixed it in. We need to do another phase of that still. We didn't get the outer perimeter of the baseball diamond done, but we got the main area where they're working in. So we're hoping to do a little additional work on that. As I mentioned, the ball field project in its entirety took on a lot of life form. And so unfortunately our chair and he was our secretary and treasurer and many other hats, both stepped down this year, so after that project. So we've been kind of rebuilding membership at this point in time. We just last month elected a new chair, Jason Hunter, a vice chair, Megan Gump, a new treasurer, Harry Bovio, and a few other members that came along with Conway Youth Sports, like Julie Petty and John Heffernan. So as usual, we're seeking more volunteers, as always. but we do have a whole new committee who are learning their new positions. We did create a Parks, Recs, and Trails calendar on the town website, so if you're looking to utilize any of the spaces down there, we've had requests in the past for like birthday parties to be there or other, like the Chesbro Challenge happens there. So we have created a calendar where you can see if something's going to be going on and you can reserve it if you were to do something special like that. And we also provided signage at the ball field in regards to trash and dogs. So you can elaborate on the latter part of that. that was good. So this coming year, we're going to work with the Conway Youth Sport programmers to continue with the merger of our two groups. We're going to CPA. While you were talking, I was thinking. We are going to look out to probably the CPA at this point to look for funding. What happened with the ball field project is there were cuts that needed to be made, and one of the major cuts was storage. And since the rebuild of the dugouts didn't happen, which was part of the storage plan, we have lost storage down there. So we do not have place for a lot of the soccer equipment and the baseball equipment, the snow blower for the ice rink. All of the ice rink sits outside in the parking lot and takes up a whole parking spot. So we're going to be looking for funding, and the thought was to go before the group and look for the funding to do the dugouts that contained the storage that would suffice the immediate need. We used to have on the old ball field a storage shed there. It was a little gray thing that seems to have been taken away and not returned. So we're lacking in storage. We do have the one building down there, but it is stacked to the brim. And that building was actually designed so we could serve food or snacks out of it for baseball games. And we really can't do that with a snowblower inside of it. It's kind of not the greatest idea. So we'll be looking for that and working on that project. I said the ice rinks. We're going to continue to fund the senior yoga. And we're going to be working with the 250th committee, my other hat tonight, to support a trail road race of some sort for the celebration weekend. We're looking at a possible winter carnival if we have snow. Cold weather dependent on that one. Working on parks, rec and trails and Conway Youth Sports Manual, and continuing to enlist additional parks, rec and trails members. So if you all are not busy and want another committee, you know where to find us. So that's that hat. Now on to the 250th. So I'm the chair of the 250th as well. Our celebration is coming up this year. So all this hard work for the last 5 years is finally going to happen. This past year we had a bunch of fundraisers, and we've done pretty good at raising some extra funds for the event. We had a sock hop at the grammar school where people could come down, have a spaghetti dinner, and dance on Valentine's Day. Or around Valentine's Day. We had Irish road bowling, which I know we had some nice select board members who came and participated in a wonderful Irish road bowling event. If you have never tried this, anybody can do it. It's a 2-pound cannonball. You roll it down the road, and then you follow it. And then you roll it again. So it's really simple, but a lot of fun. So we'll be having another one of those events. We did kick off our beer contest. Example A.
I owe you money.
You owe me money. Exactly. That's on record now.
It's growing with interest.
So if you haven't heard about our beard contest, the beard contest is if you shave your beard off and you send me a photo of your shaven face and you enter $10, you get entered into the contest, and there will be winners announced at the main celebration.
How long does it take to grow a beard?
Well, so we thought everybody would want to do it for a year. That hasn't been the case. So we've kind of done as long, you can enter at any point in time, and, you know, we'll judge you based on that.
So, there are different categories.
There will be different, yes, exactly. Different categories, you know, maybe period beards, maybe
goatees.
Short beards,
goatees,
mustaches, you know, so. Feel free, you can participate in any way you want. You don't necessarily have to be a man either to do it. Just throw that out there. We also held a logo contest this year, which you will be seeing on a bunch of our promotions coming up. And Betsy Potter was our official winner of that, so you will be seeing that unveiled shortly. We got approval from the selectmen to have the Girl Scouts build a flower bed on Shelburne Falls Road Common for the main celebration, which will be flowers in the shape of the word Conway with the number 250 coming off the O in the opposite direction. So they're working on a bronze award for their Girl Scout badges that they decided this would work well with. So we'll be looking for that. We had another successful Chesbro Challenge. We did receive sponsors this year for fireworks, transportation, and music events for the main celebration, so that helped our budget a bunch. So we were able to double the amount of time we're going to have for fireworks. So we'll have about a 25-minute or so fireworks display going on the main celebration. We're going to have music for Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. We have about 15 different acts coming. And we have some trolleys coming for transportation and some buses that have been donated, so lots of good work going on there. Hopefully you've all caught our wonderful Route 116 sign by now. Not even down.
Can't miss it.
Can't miss it. That's the goal. Exactly. Let's see. What else can I tell you? We have been collaboratively working with lots of committees in this town, so if I have not met with your committee and you wanted to talk with us, please reach out to me. But we have met with a lot of committees in this town. We have lots of good ideas. We have the Historic Society working with us and the Conway Grammar School. So our theme this year is I'm going to say it wrong. I always do. Honoring the past and embracing the future. So we've got the past covered. We've got lots of people on the committee who have been here for a lot of years. History is covered. We started talking about the future, and we realized that the kids of Conway really are our future. So we've reached out to the grammar school, and we're working with the Historical Society, who are trying to get a cultural council grant to teach our children about the history of Conway as part of their curriculum this year. And then also working with them to help put together floats or displays or plays that will show what it means to be a fifth grader in Conway in 2017 or a kindergartner, or we're doing it by class. So we're really hoping that we can show off what the future looks like for Conway and what our kids see it as, you know. So that should be a fun event to look forward to. We've also engaged with the, and I'm going to say this wrong, Kendrolling Paper Cooperative. They're up at the old grammar school, and they are taking recycled rags, if you have any, clean recycled rags, and you can go and have a workshop with them, and they're creating paper pulp, which they then make their paper out of, and they will be making paper lotuses that we can use for the floats and stuff in the parades. So they've reached out and really want to participate with our group in the events. They're hoping to have some open houses on that weekend as well to show off the school and what they do, and invite maybe past alumni of Conway Grammar School who went there to the school. We are going to be having a Lester Stevens art show in the library. Lester Stevens is an, I guess, world-renowned artist, and the Historical Commission, I think I got that right. It's either Commissioner Society, I'm supposed to. are holding that at the library. So, let's see. I haven't gone over everything, but there's a lot on here. As always, with every committee, our biggest problem is going to be volunteers this year. We've got a lot of ideas going on, a lot of community groups helping us work on stuff, but when it comes down to it, we're really going to just need people to volunteer for a half hour, an hour on any given day. So if you're interested, if you feel you have that time, if you could just shoot us an email at conway250th, with a TH on it, at gmail.com, and just tell us what day and you're free and what time, we'll put you on a list somewhere and we'll have you do something, because we're just... that's what we're going to need, is the actual volunteers.
Thank you, Heidi. Wow. Any questions for anybody? Go ahead,
Jake. So, can I talk about the broadband committee?
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's okay. So try to make this quick, but after lots of negotiations, the state has finally completed the negotiations with Comcast to extend Conway and 10 other towns' partial cable system, to expand it in all of these towns to exceed 96% of the town. And in Conway, it's probably going to be closer to 98 or 99% of the town. And almost every home in Conway will finally be connected, be able to connect to Conway's cable system. The deal was signed on August 17th. They had 3 months then to go around and look at all of the poles to determine what work they had to do for the poles. So that that'll be in about a month. They then have about another month to give us maps to show us the homes that they will or will not connect. So that should be the middle of December. They will then have three months then to complete the engineering work, and then 6 months to connect half of the houses. So about 15 months from now, half of the houses that are going to get connected should be connected across all of the 11 towns. And at some point, they will tell us which homes those are, but they're not telling us that yet. And then they'll have 6 more months to complete the other half of the houses. So that's the plan.
Thank you, Bob. Bob, you have something for fire?
Yeah, the fire department has been working on a few items this past year. Because of necessity, mostly, we're trying to grow with the modern way people walk in the woods, recreational areas along the South River and the Deerfoot River. We've had a lot of problems this past year, especially on the Deerfoot River, when you have 150, 200 people a day diving into the water at our Brattle Spray Bridge and floating down better than 3 miles from the river in Conway. Somebody would be jumping in even up further. So we've had to redevelop the fire department a little bit, and we formed what we call a river rescue crew. We took some of our money from our equipment last year, and we were able to purchase it with the graciousness of the Crabapple Whitewater Group in Charlemont. Sold us a brand new river raft rescue boat for 40% discount, which was a wonderful thing. And we now have that. But then when we got that, we tried to figure out, you know, how we're going to transport it, because the thing is 12 feet long, and you try to leave it in a blown up position at all times. So we were able to secure a free trailer from Bass DCR. It's like a 5-year-old trailer. They eventually came through with me and DCR. So we got that. We were able to keep our four-wheeler and the boat in it. It's big enough for both. And that's stored at town garage or outside the fire station right now. And the other thing that we've been training all summer on that. We've probably half the force trained in what they have to do, and they've been Crabapple Whitewater has helped us in some of the training. Charlemont Fire Department also helped us a lot with it. So they've been doing that a lot. Our next thing we can see, because we've had a little bit of issues and I expect a lot more, is the more we open space in this community, the more the people get out into the wilderness and Conway on the trails, and somebody gets injured. We've always had a couple rescues out where we were able to get out into the state forest and stuff with a pickup to get them out of there. But I can see it coming in the future where they're going to be out on some snowmobile trail or something somewhere where you can't get a pickup into them. And we've got to try to address how we're going to handle that to get them out safely. And to go along with that, we're just at talking stage now of possibly getting together with a trails committee and try to get, because everybody carries a cell phone today, or most people do. And if they don't know where they are, as long as they stay on the phone, our dispatch centers can earmark where they are. They can't pinpoint where they are, but they can get you within a few feet of it. But that's only part of the problem. The other problem is to figure out where that GPS reading is. Okay, they can give you coordinates like between streets or something and give you the coordinates to get. So I'm hoping so we can get together with the Practicing Trails Committee and maybe get some sort of program going where we, at every intersection or something, we could put a GPS reading stake up or something like that, so that somebody's injured, if they're now alone with somebody else, they can go to that nearest point and get a reading so we can zero in on it closer and quicker. Because when you have to start striking out of the state forest in Conway, when we have over 4,000 acres of state forest, looking for somebody and not really know where you're going, that can be very time consuming. Mm-hmm. And that's a detriment to the people you can help. Mm-hmm. So we're trying to work out some details on that to make it much better.
Great.
And we intend on a lot of things coming up this next year with the 250th. On Saturday, we're going to have a meet and greet. The fire department out displays out here in the ball field with all the equipment. So everybody can come and pick up the equipment, you put it on. See, you see what all the firemen go through in a community. We've got a very robust fire department right now. We've got 24 to 26 people on the average. And we have 8 juniors, which is kids from 14 to 18 coming up through the ranks, which is very successful too. So we have a lot of things going on that. And then it's the little kids in the community. I kept saying, you know, we've got to do something for the little children in the community. So we do this fire safety program in the community. So to get them all fired up this year, we had the perfect time to do it. Well, when I went down to the fire class in Wilton last week, we developed a contest for the kids in Conway. Now everybody knows that the taxpayers voted to buy a new fire truck. So we have a contest going down to Graham School right now. I don't know if any of you have grandchildren or children in them. That every kid is asked to give the fire truck a new name. And we're going to have a contest that the firemen are going to, all the kids are submitting their names. All they're giving us from information is the name, the grade they're in, and a student ID number that the principal issued the kid. Okay? Because we don't want to know any names. right now. Okay? We don't want that to influence our decision. So the kids are all cranked to the max about it. I understand it's quite a buzz down in the grammar school this is going on, and that'll be picked before the spring when the fire truck comes in. And we'll be having a debut at the grammar school when the new truck comes in. And hopefully the TV channels and stuff can be there, and the newspaper reporters, where the kid unveils, the child is picked, he unveils the name on the fire truck.
Or she.
Or she, that's right. And they get a prize. Every contest has a prize.
Sure.
So we decided the student can pick himself, three of his best friends, and their teacher, and they all go for a ride in the brain fracture. So they are all great. You all keep saying to me, if I don't win, can I get a ride? You know, it's a funny thing. The kids are really cranked to the max about this. And I think it's a good thing, good spirit for the grammar school.
Great idea.
So that's what we're up to.
Thank you, Bob. Tom has an update on the Ag Commission.
Yeah, first I'd like to say I was awfully pleased to hear that we had a boat now, naval capacity as it were, and he's not now only Chief Baker, he is now Admiral. So I think that's a substantial.
The Conway Navy.
It's only a robot. The motor is the R.
Nelson started somewhere.
Yeah, right.
So for the Agriculture Commission, who sent their collective regrets, the AgCom has finished writing the first draft of their proposed Conway Right to Farm bylaw, or that would be the second draft, the first one not having passed town meeting, which we believe addresses the needs of the town and the concerns raised the last time Right to Farm was brought to town meeting. We will be posting the draft publicly, and we'll have an open forum to hear people's feedback, which is currently planned for January. A final draft will be prepared in time for a vote at the 2017 town meeting. Moving forward, we hope to add members to our commission and continue compiling a directory of all agriculture taking place in Conway, as well as dealing with any agricultural items or concerns as they come up. Thanks, Jason Silverman. Participation runs in the family.
I'd like to do just a quick report about the ambulance department, who was unable to make it tonight because they're all on emergency call. So right now, Conway has only four EMTs. One of them is off to college. It's a college student. And the other three are in town. They are in bad need of additional help, and I mean seriously bad need of help. Because if these four throw the towels in, we've got to understand where we're headed. We're headed into a on-call force from another bigger town. And you're going to really pay through the nose for it, financial-wise. So if any of you know anybody that might be interested in becoming an EMT, please let General Vanderhill know. She's our director. And also, she has met with the select board and us, and we're coming up with part of the problem of EMTs was they had to fund the course themselves out of their pocket before they became an EMT, and it was close to $1,000. So the town is coming up with a plan that any new people that might be interested, that the town will fund the money ahead of time, so that it doesn't have to come out of their own personal pockets. We think that's probably part of the problem. But the biggest problem is the time-consuming job they have to do. But, you know, without our EMTs, we all know, God forbid, I know I've ridden in the ambulance once or twice in my life. I hope I never do again, but it can happen to any of us. So if any of you do know something, please let the gentleman know who they are. I'd be interested. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Dave, you had something?
Yeah, a couple of comments, John, if you will. I think everyone here is very impressed with the amount of work that's being done by so few people. Not only the people represented here, but those who you represent in your committees. And I think it's an extraordinary accomplishment just to consider what the volunteers do in this town. By the same token, we've noticed the elephant in the room. And I'm afraid to walk out of here without having some
plan, some kind of response from the select board to say, we know this is a huge problem, volunteers, human resources, and we've got to do something about it. I can tell you, I have put ads in the Visitor, in articles that I've written for the Visitor, asking for volunteers. I put it on Facebook. I put it in Recorder articles that I have written. Almost every article that I write for any of these media are including some request for volunteers and a phone number to call and so forth. I don't need to make a big pitch here. Tom is working very hard on this, but I do think that we should have a very formal, underscored, emphasized project here in this town to work on this most important goal. I didn't mention it, but I'm retiring from the EMD in June. So there has to be an assistant manager, EMD manager, right now to learn the ropes so that we have at least somewhat qualified EMD in July. And we've all talked about EMTs. I don't need to remind you all. So what I'm saying is, and this is a plea to you guys, to please go back and put on your agenda a serious discussion and deliberation about what are we going to do about organizing the volunteers in this town, about recruiting them, about training them, about getting them. It's not a pie-in-the-sky kind of a project. I work at the hospital several days a week. We have a volunteer coordinator there who has 300 volunteers under her guidance. 300 volunteers. That's no mistake. It is no error. It is no accident. And it is not the result of putting a memo in an email somewhere saying, if you know of anybody, please come. It is a result of a lot of hard work, face-to-face, one-on-one marketing to get people interested, to understand what the jobs are, and to know what's required of them and who's involved, and to have an inventory of all of the things that are required in town to get these resources put together for this town. Otherwise, one by one, these groups, I think, I'm not a pessimist, but I think they're going to fail for lack of interest. So please, select board, take it on yourselves to add that to your agenda, even if you have to have it on your agenda every single meeting to talk about.
To go along with that, one little bit, I forgot to mention I was on fire, but you've probably seen an advertisement in the Greenfield Recorder coming out. It's like it's due to come out the end of this week, not like it is, where they're going to advertise all the fire departments in Franklin County are going to have advertisements in there. We've submitted an article from the fire department, a bunch of pictures. They have all departments there throughout the county. And that's basically what that is, to try to spark interest. Maybe people will see this pictures and the stories and say, you know, maybe I would be interested in joining something like that. But that's getting the public awareness out there into your hands, into the newspapers.
It's awareness. And if you talk with people around town and you say, how would you like to get involved? Oh, what's involved with that? They don't know. People who aren't in our group,
right.
They don't understand. Some understand naively, so, Jack. They come in and say, oh my God, I'm not getting involved in that. But if we had job descriptions, if we had even brief little brochures to say, these are the things that are required of you. One meeting a year, or one meeting a month, or whatever the requirements are, so people understand what's involved, what kind of expertise. I mean, people have said, well, I can't do that. I don't have any expertise in that field. No, that's right. That's why you can start coming to meetings and you're gaining that expertise. So I don't want to walk out of this meeting without knowing that somebody's got the bull by the horns here.
Thanks for the comment, Dave. And certainly we need to do something at the town level to make sure that everybody knows that volunteers are needed in all our committees. You know, we have a very dedicated and hardworking staff here in town, and we have very dedicated and hardworking volunteers, but we need more of them, you know, to make the workload a little easier for everybody and to make sure we got all the bases covered in everything that we do. So, welcome suggestion. Thank you. I just want to thank Joe for being here tonight from FCAT, the Frontier Community Access Television, so that anybody who wasn't here tonight can see what we did. And Andy from the recorder, our personal reporter, who comes to many of our functions to report on what we do. And thank you all for being here tonight and for all your great suggestions and information sharing on your projects.